hai madhava paduna luchi makaranda se makaranda panakori anande bolo hari hari arenga name mandavela hari hari be chakadola se chakadola
Vasudevaya,
Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya.
chapter 14, Ideal Family Life. Today we're reading text number 9. Please repeat.
Migoshta karamakaku.
Migoshta karamakaku.
Migoshta karamakaku.
Migoshta karamakaku.
Sarish kaga makshika.
Sarish kaga makshika.
Sarish kaga makshika.
Sarish kaga makshika.
Atmana putra vat pasyat.
Atmana putra vat pasyat.
Tai esam antaram kiyat.
Tai esam antaram kiyat.
Nigostra karamarka ko.
Sarishka karamakshika. Amana putra vatpashe.
Taisham antaram kiya. Any Matajis?
Nigostra karamarka ko.
Utsriya
Utsra,
camels,
Kara,
asses,
Marka,
monkeys,
Aku,
mice, Sarish,
snakes,
Kaga,
birds,
Makshikaha, flies, Atmanaha, of oneself. Putravat,
like the
sons.
Pashyat,
one should see.
Tai,
with those sons.
Esham,
of these animals.
Antaram,
difference.
Kiyat,
how little.
Translation:
one should treat animals such as deer, camels, asses, monkeys, mice, snakes, birds, and flies, exactly like one's own son. A little difference there actually is, between children and these innocent animals. Please repeat. One should treat animals
such as deer,
camels,
asses,
monkeys,
mice,
snakes,
birds,
and flies.
Exactly like one's own son.
How little difference there actually is.
Between
children
and these innocent animals.
Purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada. Srila Prabhupada, keep. One who is in Krishna consciousness understands that there's no difference between the animals and the innocent children in one's home. Even in ordinary life, it is our practical experience that a household dog or cat is regarded on the same level as one's children without any envy. Like children, the unintelligent animals are also sons of the Supreme Personality of Godhead, and therefore a Krishna conscious person, even though a householder, should not discriminate between children and poor animals. Unfortunately, modern society has devised many means for killing animals in different forms of life. For example, in the agricultural fields, there may be many mice, flies, and other creatures that disturb production. And sometimes they are killed by pesticides. In this verse, however, such killing is forbidden. Every living entity should be nourished by the food given by the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Human society should not consider itself the only enjoyer of all the properties of God. Rather, men should understand that all the other animals also have a claim to God's property. In this verse, even the snake is mentioned, indicating that a householder should not be envious even of a snake. If everyone is fully satisfied by eating food that is a gift from the Lord, why should there be envy between one living being and another? In modern days, people are very much inclined toward communistic ideas of society, but we do not think that there can be any better communistic idea than that which is explained in this verse of Srimad Bhagavatam. Even in the communistic countries, the poor animals are killed without consideration, although they also should have the right to take their allotted food with which to live. Gora braganya gana gota guloruharam goranga guratama gopyada kopa briksham gopala gara rati damyati singha gora govinda deshika varam satatam namami. Krishna's Kaviraj Goswami describes it, prati shloki prati akshri nanartakoi, in each and every verse of the Bhagavatam, in each and every syllable of the Bhagavatam, there's unlimited meaning. And to try to fully explain one verse, even Lord Ananta Sesh, with millions of hoods, for millions of years, he can't explain even one verse completely. So there are many different ways we could speak on this verse. I'm going to take one particular point, which alone we won't have time for this morning. Vedic culture is a culture which teaches us to not be selfish. We have a very difficult time understanding this culture. I heard something recently which I was very surprised to hear. But the tradition in Sweden, the common thing is that if some guest comes to your home and you're sitting and talking with your friend, your guest, and then suddenly it's time for your meal, they'll commonly ask the guest, please go in the other room while I take my meal. That's a big shock. It's not Indian culture. Indian culture understands that Atithi Bhagavan, that that person who comes unannounced to your house, we treat that person like we do the Lord. And we treat all living entities with respect, because we see the Lord in the bodies of all living entities. Atmanam putravat pasyat. We see all living entities the same as we do our own children. People in the world today are very concerned that we give up sectarianism, that we give up divisions. And people think that global unity is a solution for things. That's a very big subject. I won't go into that, but if you study it, you can see that the so-called unity is actually destroying cultures. Really what it is they're exporting Mickey Mouse and Coca-Cola all over the world and destroying cultures, which destroys morality, which destroys families, and this is going on all over the world in the name of unity. But real unity we find in Vedic culture, in Indian culture. To this day, I've been living in Orissa for the last 23 years. And to this day, in the small villages, it's common that the people, the first chapati that they cook of the day, the first bit of rice, they give that to the cow. And they'll save some chapatis for the dogs. They'll save some food for the hungry people. They'll put aside some, flour outside to feed the ants. They feed all the creatures because it's understood. If you're a grihastha, all these other creatures are also part of my family, and I should respect them. So as we were speaking the other day in the first day, there's three types of charity: deha doya, mana doya, and atma doya. And each one of these is a very big subject, and each one of these is an important subject. Maharaj was speaking very nicely, Bhakti Raghava Maharaj, about the importance in Vedic culture of all three of these things, and the connection between all three of these things with Atma Doya. We may do some Deha Doya, or charity to the body, but that Deha Doya is also connected with Atma Doya. And we gave an example the first day how the Vedic literature suggests you plant trees, especially beside the road, and you dig wells. And that's a very nice, pious act. And by doing that, you'll get some sukriti. But if one day some sadhu, some Vaishnav Mahatma comes and he drinks from that well, or he sits under the shade of that tree, then you get a different kind of sukriti. You get bhakti unmukhi sukriti. So Vedic culture is a culture which teaches everybody to be respectful to everyone in the hope that someday you may give some charity to a sadhu, to a Vaishnav sadhu, and then your bhakti vritti will begin. Is manodaya, charity to the mind. We should open up schools. We should educate people. And in Vedic culture, once Srila Prabhupada was asked, which is better, the worshippers of Kali, and a lot of them are not vegetarian, or the Christians? And Prabhupada said the worshippers of Kali. The devotees were surprised. How is that? Prabhupada said because they're within the Vedic pantheon. They're within the Vedic system. And if they have respect for Kali Mata, then by giving respect to her, they may read some of the books about her. They may read something about her husband, Mahadev Shivji. And then reading more books about him, they may read he's Vaishnavanam Yatashambhu. They may read how Kali is Vaishnavi Devi. And they're great devotees of Krishna. And so in that way, they may come to the point of reading something about the Supreme Lord. So there's something given for everyone. And Vedic culture. And Vedic culture is that culture which is a culture of respect. Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, Deho Nata Jata Jata. We give respect to everyone. There's a science of respect, but we give respect according to their position. Chaitanya Sikshamrita is a whole subject for another class. He gives eight different reasons why we give respect. Nara Matara Mariyada. We give respect to anyone who's a human being. But more than that, Sabhyatara Mariyada, someone who's a cultured human being. More than that, to Vidya Mariyada, someone who's educated. More than that, to Sadguna Mariyada, someone who has good qualities. Excuse me, I missed one. Raja Mariyada, someone who's a leader. And then more than Sadguna Mariyada, we give respect to Varna Mariyada, someone who's acting according to their Varna, and especially the Brahmins. More than that, Ashram Mariyada, we give respect to persons who follow ashram. It's very, very rare, even in India today, to see brahmacharis and proper grihasthas and what to speak of sannyasis. But the most of all, Bhaktivinoda says, lastly, we give respect to Bhakti Mariyada, to someone who has devotion. And it may be a small child, it may be a housewife, it may be whatever. This is our culture of Daivivan Ashram, where we keep Krishna prominently in the center. So we give respect to all living entities. There's a very nice lecture Srila Prabhupada gave on Nectar of Devotion in Mumbai in 1973. I'd like to read you this excerpt from this. Prabhupada said, in this old age, we are wandering all over the world to see that let everyone become happy by Krishna consciousness. And Prabhupada said, in this old age, we're wandering all over the world, wanting to see everyone happy. By becoming Krishna conscious. He said, it's not that we love only our countrymen, only Hindus or Bengalis or Madrasis. No. We love everyone, even the animals. But because human beings can understand the Krishna philosophy, therefore we hold meetings of the human beings. We don't generally hold meetings of the dogs. Or give class to the cows. But still, Prabhupada said, whenever we get an opportunity, we give protection to the animals. We give them prasadam. We do not prohibit if some animal comes to hear. Prabhupada said they also hear sometimes. Everyone can hear, even if they don't understand what is Hare Krishna. If you chant loudly, even the ant and insect whose hearing will be delivered because it is a spiritual vibration. Recently, in one of our publications, we translated an interesting verse from a rare book called the Subhashita Ratna Bhandagara. A nice verse which illustrates the beauty of this same point of how Vedic culture can elevate even the smallest creatures. Asajjana sajjana sanghi sangat kuroti dusadim apiha sadyam puspasrayach chambu siro dirudha papilika chumbati chandrabimbam. The word papilika means an ant. There's a similar word in the Ori language. They call it pinpoi, little ant, very insignificant creature. Asajana sajana sangi sangat. In association with broad-minded souls, with great persons, even that person who's an asajana, who's a great rascal, karoti dusadyam api asadyam, he can achieve the impossible. Just like an ant, very insignificant creature, but an ant, that ant can touch the moon. If that ant is associating with a flower on the head of Lord Shiva, Lord Shiva has the moon on his head, the ant is attached to a flower, someone offers the flower to Lord Shiva, so that ant gets the opportunity to associate, to touch the moon, an impossible thing. This is Vedic culture. Durgata gata navidachi. Krishna can make even the impossible possible. And he does this, Krishna Kripa Srimurti, through the medium of his devotees. And Srila Prabhupada says that whenever we get opportunity, we give protection to the animals. We give them prasadam. We do not prohibit if some animal comes to hear. This is our culture. It's a really non-sectarian culture. It's a culture that reaches out to all living entities. A few years ago, we made an issue of our Krishna Katamrita magazine on the subject of Srimad Bhagavatam. And within that issue, we printed a story along with a photo. I don't have a copy with me today. I'll show you. A very interesting story, which began, I think, in the year 2004. There's a famous, an ancient temple, many ancient temples, in Bhubaneswar. There's one, the Kapaleshwar Mahadev temple, temple of Lord Shiva. And since, I don't know, for the last more than 30 years now, they've had a tradition. Every year in the month of March, usually around Gaur Purnima time, they have a 9-day recitation of Srimad Bhagavatam. So, we found this article in the newspaper, in the Ria newspaper, and the article made a play on an interesting, famous Oriya saying, Sanda Sunichi Bhagavat. Sanda Sunichi Bhagavat means, Sanda means a bull. Sanda Sunichi Bhagavat, the bull who's hearing the Bhagavat. And it's a kind of joke. What's the value of a bull hearing the Bhagavatam? Right? But Srila Prabhupada, he says in this lecture, he says, we do not prohibit if some animal comes to hear. They also hear sometimes. And we want to give in charity to them. So this saying, Sanda Sunichi Bhagavat, or the bull in the Bhagavat, the newspaper said, gained a new meaning this year. In the year 2004, after 22 years of this Bhagavat recitation there, the people were gathered together and it's set up and they were sitting down, getting ready to hear the Bhagavatam. And then suddenly a big bull came into the temple courtyard and he sat down right there amongst the devotees. He's creating a disturbance. So the devotees tried to push him away, and he was a little bullish. He didn't want to move, and they couldn't do anything with him. He just sat there. And then they were surprised as soon as the recitation finished, the bull got up and walked away. That was the first day. And the second day, he came right on time, and he sat down. They couldn't get rid of him again. And the whole recitation of the Bhagavatam, he sat there. And then when it finished, he got up and left. For 9 days he did that. Everybody was very amazed. And they forgot all about it. Until the next year, in 2005, they again had their recitation of the Bhagavatam. And the same bull came. On the first day, at the beginning of the recitation. And he sat down. Nobody could move him. And at the end of the recitation, that day he got up and left. And every day he would come, and every day that he would go. So then in 2006, they were wondering, is this bull going to come again? And there was a newspaper reporter there. And he took a photo of that bull who came every day to hear the Bhagavatam. So this is Vedic culture. It's a culture which is open for all living entities. It's a culture which gives everyone some opportunity to make some progress. In the Uttarakhanda, of the Padma Purana, there's a section of the Bhagavat Mahatmya, the glories of the Bhagavatam. There's a very wonderful story many of you probably know about the devotee Gokarna and how he had done a Bhagavat recitation on behalf of his brother Dundubi, who had become a ghost. It's a long story. But the Padma Purana describes that when he finished that recitation, Dundubi became freed from his form as a ghost. And he went to the spiritual world. The Vaikuntha airplane came and took him away. And it's interesting that Padma Purana notes that although there were many other people there, only Dundubi got liberation. And the question is raised, and why not everyone else? And the answer is given that they weren't listening in a proper way. Yesterday, Bhakti Raghava Maharaj was citing an important thing in Vedic culture. We have to have Shravana Adhikara, the qualification to hear. Ramanujacharya, in his commentary in the Bhagavad Gita, he says there's three aspects, which Maharaj touched on yesterday, which constitute Shravana Adhikara, the right to hear. Pranipata, Pariprasna, and Seva. We have to be submissive. We have to inquire in a proper way. And we have to render service. So because they hadn't listened in a proper way, they didn't get the proper result. So then later, Gokarna performed another yajna of the Bhagavatam. Again, he spoke the Bhagavatam. And that time, everyone was very attentive. And the Padma Purana says a very interesting thing. Tadgrama yestita jiva ashvachandala jataya vimane stapitashte pi Gokarna kripaya tada. That Gokarna kripaya tada, by the mercy of Gokarna, all the living entities in that village, including even the dogs and the dog eaters, there was a Vaikuntha airplane that came for all of them, including the dogs and the dog eaters, and everyone was given liberation. This is Vedic culture. We see many stories. Yesterday in the Bhagavatam class, we heard something about Shivananda Singh's dog. We also see in the Mahabharata how Yudhisthira Maharaj, when he ascended, left this world, he also took a dog with him and showed so much mercy on that dog. In the Chaitanya Mangal, Lord Chandas Thakur gives a nice story which we printed in one of our email magazine, issue 30. And he says that one day, this is around the time when Nimai Pandit Mahaprabhu was about 5 years old. And he was playing with some of his friends and they discovered a group of puppies. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Nimai Pandit, he picked out one puppy and some of his friends became a little unhappy. They said, "Hey, you took the cutest puppy. That's not fair." And then Nimai said, no, we can all play with this puppy. Come to my house." And just as they were going, Mother Sachi was leaving from the house. "Very good. Mother's not here now. No one's here in the house." So they took the dog inside the house. And they started playing with the dog. And sometimes they were going outside and they were rolling in the dust with the dog. And at one point, the boys started quarreling. Boys do. Even Nimai Pandit is quarreling with his friends. And one of them said, "This is not fair. You picked out the best dog. You're always doing like this." And they had some quarrel. And that boy became angry and left. And he ran down to the bank of the Ganga. And he went to Sachi Mata. And he said, "You know what your boy is doing? He's playing with the dog, the puppy. You go and see for yourself." Sachi Mata became very unhappy. And she came back and she saw it was true. There was her Nimai with a little puppy dog on his lap. And she began to chastise him. "What are you doing? You're the son of a Brahmin, Jagannath Mishra. Why are you taking this very low-class animal, this dog, like this?" Nimai said, "But Mata, he's very beautiful. I like him." His mother said, "You can't have a dog." "No, I like him very much." And then Sachi Mata, she was very intelligent. She said, "Anyway, you tie your dog up here and go take a bath in the Ganga with your friends. You can play in the water." And Nimai said, "Very good." And Sachi Mata said, "I'll watch your dog. Don't worry. I'll watch your puppy." And Nimai went to take a bath in the Ganga. And while he was gone, Sachi Mata, she said, "Anyway, I'll tell him that I don't know what happened to him, he just ran away." And she untied the dog, and the dog left. And when Nimai came back, he was looking for the dog, and one of his friends told him, "Your Mata untied the dog." And me and my pundit became very, very unhappy with his mother. Why you did like that? That's very bad. I love that dog. It's not good. And Lobsang Das Thakur, he says, how amazing it is that Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, although he's a supreme personality of Godhead, he was kind to that dog. And he gives a very beautiful description of what happened after that. I'll sing this in Bengali, and you can chant Hare Krishna in response, please.
Gauranga parase kukur bhagyavan swabhava chadiyata vaila dibya yan bolo Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Parasha Kukura Bhagyavan.
By the touch of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, that kukur, that dog, became Bhagyavan, became very, very fortunate. And so Bhava Chadiya, it gave up its dog's nature. And Taro Hoyla Dibya Gyan, that dog became full of transcendental knowledge by the mercy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And then something happened to that dog.
Radha Krishna Govinda Boliya Dake Nache Nadiyana Loka Deki Sabagaya Pache Bolo Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare.
I don't know how it was possible, but Lochan Das Thakur says that dog started running around and started calling out, Radha Krishna Govinda Boliyadaki Nachi, and began dancing like anything.
Bhakti Sripadamana Maharaj told me once that he has his temple in the base of Radhakund, and that there was a dog living there at Radhakund, and he used to come and offer obeisances and put his head on the feet of the devotees. It was a very special dog.
So Nadiyara Loka Deki Sabadaya Pachi, everybody in Nadia, the word quickly spread. Did you hear there's a dog chanting Hare Krishna? And everybody came to see this dog who was chanting Hare Krishna and dancing.
Kukura abesha emam sabe deki pulakita sabha anga ashamoya angi bolo Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare
everybody was standing there watching. That dog, Kukura Abesha Emona Shabadeki, Pulakita Shaba Anga, Ashramoya Angi. He exhibited on all the different limbs of his body various symptoms of divine ecstasy. An amazing thing. I don't have such good fortune. He's a dog. And he's crying. And body's shivering. Goosebumps coming on the dog. The dog's hairs are standing on him. He's rolling on the ground and chanting Radha Krishna Govinda. And everybody was seeing that. And then at that time,
Achandite Swanadeha Chadi Bhagyavan Krishna Loka Haina Kore Goloke Payan Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Krishna Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama.
Chandite Swana Deha Chari, that soul, the body, that dog, suddenly gave up his body. And Krishna Loke Hanya Kore Goloke Payan. Suddenly a Vaikuntha airplane came. And that dog chanting Radha Krishna Govinda Govinda. Well, the soul of that dog. No longer a dog. Got on that divine chariot and went back to the spiritual world. And Lochan Das Thakur says a very amazing thing happened at that time. That all the demigods, they all came. And the demigods began to offer prayers to the Lord. Jaya Jaya Kripa Sindhu Satchitanandan. All glories to that ocean of mercy, the son of Mother Sachi. Emona Koruna Prabhu no Kaile Katan. You're giving mercy to a dog. Why don't you give mercy to us? The demigods.
Kukura udhara kore goloke patai
Divya deha hena kabu keha nahi pai. You delivered a dog. You gave this dog a spiritual body and took him to Goloka Vrindavan. Divya deha hena kabu keho nahi pai. Why don't you do the same thing for us? Jaya jaya agatira gati gora hari. Jaya jaya avatara sabhara upari. All glories to Gora Hari. That personality who's agatira gati, who gives shelter to persons who have no shelter. Jaya jaya avatara sabhara upari. He's the best of all the avatars. Tora kurunaya kalijiva nishariva. Arakiva lila tora alokika hubba. By your mercy, all the souls who are living in Kali Yuga will be delivered. Such amazing pastimes you're doing. Mora sabha deva kabir habi bhagyavan pai bitomara pada prasarat pradan. When will we get your prasad? When will we get your mercy? When will we become bhagyavan or fortunate? Kukura toriya jai tomara parasi e mona karuna kabu nahi rishikeshi. You touched this dog, and you delivered a dog. Even as Krishna, we never heard about Krishna playing with dogs, or delivering a dog. But Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, you're so wonderfully munificent, wonderfully merciful, wonderfully magnanimous. Kaviraj Goswami says three times, he's the most amazing, merciful Lord. You delivered even a dog. Kabhi mora hoibe e mona bhagya ba bhagi. Kukure kritarta koile tai mora magi. When will that day come when we're fortunate? You gave perfection to a dog. And we pray that we can get the same kind of mercy as that dog. When will that day come to us? We worship the sun by offering a lamp to the sun. We worship the Ganga by offering Ganga Jal. And we worship that personality, Adosha Darshi, Mora Prabhu Nityananda. That Nityananda Prabhu and Gauranga Mahaprabhu, we worship them by ourselves being Adosha Darshi. We worship that Mahavadanyaya avatar, that most merciful incarnation of the Lord, by ourselves becoming merciful. Sometimes we've seen that Vaishnavas, I don't like to use the word traditional Vaishnavas, especially Gaudiya Vaishnavas, because Gaudiyas are really not traditional. They're very extraordinary in every way. But for lack of a better word, what you might call traditional Gaudiya Vaishnavas in India who grew up in that culture, sometimes they're a little surprised to see Srila Prabhupada's dancing white elephants. And sometimes they say things like, wait a minute, dancing white elephants, you're not supposed to wear shoes. Elephants are not supposed to wear shoes in the kirtan. They'll say things like that because they can't understand and appreciate the magnanimity, the wonderful mercy of Srila Prabhupada. And sometimes they say, you Westerners, what kind of preaching can you do? You don't know Bengali, you don't know Sanskrit, you don't know Vaishnava Siddhanta properly, you don't know Vaishnava culture. What kind of preaching can you do? But Srila Prabhupada sent all the devotees out. On the first day, I was telling a story to someone, I think yesterday, before I joined this movement, I was living in a cave. I'm a caveman. I was living in a cave on Mount Lemmon in Arizona. And I was chanting Hare Krishna. I'd met the devotees before. I was a vegetarian. I was trying to chant 16 rounds and living in my cave. And I stayed there for some weeks. It was really boring. And after some time I decided, man, forget it, I want to go meet the devotees. So I went down to the nearest town, which happened to be Tucson, Arizona, and at that time there was no temple there, and I knew that. And I was speaking to someone on the street, and I was saying, you know, those Hare Krishna people, they're really good, I really like them. And this man said, you know, Hare Krishna devotees were just here yesterday at the university, but they left. I said, oh, that's really very sad. I said, but don't worry, there's a sitar concert tonight, a free sitar concert at the university. So I thought, that's cool, I'll go to that. So I went and I found that he was wrong. The devotees were still there. They had a Festival of India booth set up, and all the devotees were wearing hats and jeans and dressed as non-devotees, and they had some displays about reincarnation, vegetarianism, and they were low profile. Right? And I went up to them and I said, I know who you guys are. You guys are Hare Krishnas, aren't you? And they gave me, much to my happiness, a big plate of prasadam. And they were getting ready to pack up Madhua Prabhu and Charu Prabhu, Krishna Pratap. At that time, Charu Prabhu came over to me just before they were leaving, and he brought me this big box of Bhagavad Gitas. And he said, here, go sell these. I was a caveman. Carried down in the middle of my back. When the last time I bathed, I wasn't the cleanest creature in the world. I didn't know Bhagavad Gita or Vaishnava Siddhanta, but he gave me that box of books. I said, okay. And I went and I started stopping students, saying, hey, did you get one of these? We have this book, please take this book. And I tried to sell that. This is Srila Prabhupada's movement. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, it said that Uttama Adama Kichana Bhachira Jachya Dilekako. The poet Premananda Das, he sings that although Mahaprabhu, he doesn't consider who's Uttam, who's Adam, Kichana Bhachira, he freely gives mercy to everyone. And that's this movement. Although we're not qualified, from the first day, we're being told, go out and distribute this mercy. But then we may say, but I'm not qualified to do that. How will I distribute this properly? He may make a mistake. If you give a box of Bhagavad Gita to some crazy person who's living in a cave and tell him to go and sell them, he may say something wrong. It's not maybe. It's definitely. He'll definitely say something wrong. Of course he will. But still, some benefit will be there. Benefit will be there for the persons who may take that book. Benefit will be there for the persons who just see him with the book. Prabhupada said. Benefit will be there for the person, that caveman, who is trying to distribute the book. And so Srila Prabhupada, he's jump-started our movement. We have no adhikar, we have no qualification. But immediately he said, you go and you distribute this thing. You be some instrument. Because by doing that, we can attract the mercy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in a very, very amazing way. I'll just read you a short excerpt from the purport of Srila Prabhupada, which definitely exhibits and displays the amazing quality of Mahaprabhu's mercy. Prabhupada writes in Chaitanya Charitamrita Madhya Lila chapter 13. He says that one should understand that all the devotees in this Krishna consciousness movement who are dedicated to distributing the mercy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he said, they're already Nitya Siddha. They're already eternal associates of the Lord. Because this movement right now is Gaura Lila. And Vrindavan Das Thakur, he says that Krishna, remember? First word? Chaitanya Bhagavan. He says a number of times in Chaitanya Bhagavat that this Gaura Lila is going on right now. Adyapiha Chaitanya he Shabha Lila Kori Jakwane Jahari Kori Drishti Yari Kori. Adyapiha, right now, right here, in this place, Gaura Lila is going on. The Panchatattva are here, the devotees are chanting the Maha Mantra, they're serving Srila Prabhupada, they're serving the devotees in the cyclic succession. This is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's movement, and Mahaprabhu is present here today. So if we want to take part in this movement, we have to try to imbibe that mood of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. I know we're about finished our time, but I'd like to just share a couple of verses with you from Chaitanya Bhagavat, Anjalila chapter 3. Pramad, pranamed, dandavad, bhumo, ashwachandalago karam, pravishto jiva kalayata triva bhagavaniti. That realizing that the Supreme Lord is in everyone's body is a super soul. Pranamed, dandavad, bhumav. We should fall down to the ground and offer obeisances to everyone, even to the dogs, the outcasts, the cows, and the asses, falling flat on the ground like a rod. In chapter 20 of Anjalila, Vrindavan Das Thakur says, Brahmanadi kukura chandala anta kori dandavat kori bheka bahu manya kori. You should offer full dandavats to all living entities, including the Brahmins, including the dogs, including the dog eaters. This is Vaishnavism.
Uttamahana Vaishnava Haki Nira Abhiman Jivi Samana Dibi Jani Krishna Adishtan. Although a Vaishnava is the most exalted person, he has no pride. Nirabhiman. And he gives respect, Jivi Samana Dibi Jani Krishna Adishtan, to everyone, because he knows that Krishna is in the bodies of everyone. And one of my favorite verses, Ese Vaishnava Dharma Sabare Pranati Sehi Dharma Vajija Iti Nahi Rati. He says that the nature of a Vaishnava, Ese Vaishnava Dharma, this is Vaishnava Dharma. Dharma doesn't mean only religion, it means the nature or the intrinsic quality of something. Ese Vaishnava Dharma, this is the nature of a Vaishnava. What is the nature? Sabare Pranati. They give respects to everyone. To all the devotees, maybe they're initiated by a different guru, maybe they're from a different city, maybe from a different country, I give my respect. Maybe they're Gaudiya Math devotees, or Babaji devotees, maybe they're Christians, maybe they're Muslims, maybe they're cows, maybe they're dogs. But a Vaishnav, the nature of a Vaishnav is Sabare Pranati. They give respect to everyone, and they give mercy to everyone. This is generosity. Sei dharma dvajija iti nahirati. But there's another class of persons. Vrindavanas Thakur calls them dharma dvaji. Dvaji means a flag. And this is a person who has a different kind of dharma. Their dharma is to wave a flag, to show everybody that I'm a religious person. They dress up like a devotee. They advertise themselves as being a great devotee. But they're not really a devotee. Sei dharma dvajija iti nahirati. And they have no taste for giving respect to other persons like this. They have no respect to giving respect to other, no taste for giving respect to animals and other creatures like this. So we should understand, this is our movement. And Srila Prabhupada said, we give respect also to the animals. We give them prasadam, and we give them some opportunity to hear, because we want to give everyone some opportunity to get this mercy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. If you criticize other people, then you're working for someone else. You're working for someone whose name is Chitragupta. You may have heard of him before. He works for Yamaraj, and he has a book and a pen. And he writes down every little thing that people do. Eating prasadam in the bathroom. This one offered obeisances with only one hand. This one here criticized this person. This one here was picking his nose in front of the deities. Oh my God. And they make notes on all that kind of person. You know? So if you follow in that line of being a fault finder, then you're working for Yamaraj. You're working for his court. But for those persons who Adosha Darshi Mora Prabhu Nityananda, who worship Lord Nityananda, who's Adosha Darshi, who doesn't see fault, they also don't see fault. That's the nature. If you're going to worship the sun, you worship with a lamp. If you're going to worship the Ganga, you worship with Ganga Jal. If we want to worship Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, we have to be forgiving. We have to overlook the faults of others. He's a dog. No, he's dog is also a very special personality. Let me give some prasadam to him. Let me make him happy. Let me give some respect to him. Let me take care of the cows. Let me take care of the animals. Let me give respect to all living entities. And if we give respect like that to everyone, then you're working in a different court for a different judge. You're working for the judge of Nityananda Prabhu. I'm afraid to work for the court of Yamaraj. Because if I work for that court, I'll be judged in the same court. And therefore, the author Krishnadas, who sings this nice song, Adosha Darshi Mora Prabhu Nityananda, he says, Mora Prabhu, he's my Prabhu, because he's the only hope that I have. Because he's Adosha Darshi, he doesn't see fault. So I also should come to that point. And then I can really begin to practice bhakti. Why is it a dog is getting asa satyakara bhav? He's exhibiting all symptoms of ecstasy, and I don't. The dog is more fortunate than me. The dog is more elevated than me. Let me give respect to him. Somehow or other, to this point where I can really get the mercy of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And let me try to give that to others, which comes by giving respect to everyone.
So we'll stop today. We've gone
a little over.
Grantara Shimad Bhagavatam Hi. Shila Prabhupada Ki. Samaveda Bhakta Ganda Ki. Obhremanandi Hari. So, a little late, the Hari Sari Prabhu has a comment or something. Somehow I was thinking somebody was going to ask that question. The Bhagavatam says that we should feed the flies, we should treat the flies just as nicely as we do our children, and we should treat the snakes just as nicely. But the Bhagavatam also says, same canto, that a saintly person is happy when he sees an envious creature like a snake or something kill. My understanding of that is, Vedic culture is a very subtle culture. Bhaktivinoda Thakur, one place, he says that subtle discrimination is extremely important for Vaishnavas. So there's many things that we can say in this subject. It's not a black and white subject. I'll give you an example. We could say that poisonous snakes should be killed, and non-poisonous snakes are not killed because non-poisonous snakes are doing some useful things. They're catching mice and that. You may know in India there's a caste of people who capture snakes, and they play some song. They're traditionally worshippers of Krishna, devotees of Krishna. They worship Kali and Naga, Krishna who defeated Kali. But when they come to drive a cobra out, they don't kill that cobra. They give respect to it. And we see in Vedic culture, it's considered auspicious to see a cobra. If it bites you, maybe that's not so auspicious. But it's considered to be auspicious to see a cobra like that. We should offer obeisances to it. So how do we understand these two seeming distinctions? I would suggest that if that snake is coming, is a threat, is going to hurt me, and certainly if a cobra is in your house, that's definitely a threat. Once in our home in Bhubaneswar, we had a little snake come in our house. It's about this big, about as big around as my little finger. I can't remember the Aria name for them. It translates to three-step. They call it three-step snake because that's about how far you go after you're bitten, before you die. And we killed that snake. And later I showed it, the dead body of it, to one of our local friends. He became very, very frightened. So if you have a snake in your house, you should kill that thing. But it's not that we should go on a campaign like Janami Jai to kill all the snakes in the universe. That's also wrong. They also have some place and should also give respect to them. And that cobra, he's a devotee of Lord Shivji. And Shivji is a great devotee of Lord Krishna, so we can respect him, but we don't want him to come in our house. However, non-poisonous snakes, I remember seeing in New Goberdon in Australia, they had these corn snakes sometimes. Of course, they also have brown snakes too, which are one of the most poisonous snakes in the world. But those corn snakes are huge. And they had one living in the godown. And it was like a devotee, in the sense that he was doing some service. Because the mice would come and they would eat the grains and that. So the snake was there and he was having some snack of the mice. So, I know that's my humble understanding of it. Do you have any further thoughts?
No, I'm trying to call out to answer.
Okay. Please forgive me for speaking in front of you. Very sorry. Srila Prabhupada ki, Sambheda Bhakta Vinda ki, Kopremanande, Vamsa Kopri, Shatka, Sindhu Vyay, Chan, Vita
His Grace Madhavananda Prabhu ki,
Srila Prabhupada ki,